What's up, Shy Hearts?
What's up, Chicago fans?
What's up, Shy Hearts?
Welcome to One Chicago Day.
We have a lot of great stuff coming up that you won't want to miss.
So, sit back,
relax,
and enjoy.
I've had a lot of favorite scenes, favorite moments in Chicago Fire. My single favorite moment that I got to shoot was rescuing the little girl from the party store.
There you are. Come on, I got you.
Mouch, report!
You okay?
Yeah. Match. That was, I mean, wow. You okay?
Worst party ever.
Hey,
it's a beautiful shave.
I don't know if I can narrow it down to a favorite scene, but certainly one of my favorites was playing heads up with Jesse Spencer.
That's a stable table. You have that mic?
Australian?
Yes!
I was really tired, and I drank coffee for the first time in a really long time, and so the laughter that's happening is me just running on hysterics.
That was so, so terrible.
Oh, and you are a very mean person. Know that?
Yeah.
You do.
Good night, sweet dreams, mate.
Okay, that's worse than mine, and you know it.
My first scene was my favorite because I was kind of just thrown into the deep end. They were like, hey, welcome to set. This is everybody. Climb this building.
Hey, give me a hand.
Yeah. Come on.
Gallo, what the hell are you doing? Get me down from here!
I think that was a really, like, electric way to be introduced into a show.
Gallo!
Really cool way to kind of also be like, hey, I can do a lot of stuff. Let's have some fun.
Help me! Get me!
I got you, I got you.
Wow!
Just another dull day in the CFD. Am I right?
My favorite scene would be probably episode 8, where Violet has appendicitis.
You okay?
Yeah, I just... Oh! Oh, what the hell? Ow!
Okay, Violet, I think your appendix just burst. We're gonna have to get you to the hospital right now.
She's screaming her head off in an ambulance.
Give me the drugs, I'm dying in here!
It was really challenging and very, very nerve-wracking, but it was also very freeing to just scream.
You feeling better?
Don't talk to me!
I'm gonna survive, right?
Yes. You'll survive.
I have a lot of favorite scenes. Most recently, the scuba episode that we shot at the end of season 9 and the beginning of season 10. One of the most terrifying things that I ever had to do.
Bruce, you see anything over there?
Nothing.
I don't like the look inside here. 60 seconds search for the body, then we're out the way we came. Understood?
Copy.
Going in, I had no clue what scuba diving was like, and by the end of it, it was just the most thrilling experience that we ever got to do.
Fire in the hole!
One of my favorite scenes to film was coming in from the mud run with Yuri.
Who won?
He did. I think he's part mole.
A W is a W, baby!
Yeah, it is.
All right,
hey, whoa!
Whoa.
Hey, no, don't touch anything in here. I just got this place steam cleaned to the tune of 500 somolies. Stay away, go.
Well, you're really not gonna like this.
Hey!
First round's on me, Mud Runners!
I love loved getting all dirty and just having shenanigans with Otis.
Thanks for volunteering us.
My favorite scene from all the years would have to be the scene where Casey and Severide are on top of a building closing a gas line.
Severide, we gotta go!
I'm not leaving till I get this shut!
And the building is on fire, it's gonna go.
Casey, Severide, we're all clear. Get out of there now!
Copy, Chief.
So what now? As soon as we leave this thing, it's gonna blow. How many steps do you think it is to the edge of the building? To do what? Jump?
Sure. We let go, make a break for it, jump into the water.
And they look at each other, and Severide says he's gonna jump.
Get ready! Count of three!
This is insane.
Let's go! One, two!
Damn it, Casey!
Three!
And they both jump off, and a big fireball explodes. It's one of the best memories that I've had in the last 10 years.
While we do know that Atwater needs love and enjoys love, I think Officer Zora would be a perfect fit for intelligence.
You ready? Let's go.
Now, whether her and Kevin will find love, it's really up to Kevin.
Hey, don't look at me. I'm not getting in the middle of that Scott sibling beef.
And actually, we know all of the partners in intelligence are already partners. So if we just want more partnerships, no problem with me.
Patty just sent me a review where it was like, Adam and Kim's relationship is like conscious uncoupling. Like we're like the new Gwyneth and Chris, which I like. He's sleeping on my couch and we're raising a kid together and it's going very well, but we're not dating or sleeping together.
We won!
Are you kidding me?
Adam and Kim are two people that have a massive amount of love for each other. They can't quit each other on some level.
It's the classic modern family. I don't know what to tell you.
Right now, the thing that ties them together is Michaela.
One thing that we can be, you and I, is we can be this whole big round thing that can surround and protect her.
I think he'd like it to be more, but, you know, we'll see. We'll see what happens.
It's a great thing to shoot and fun to figure out because we really don't know and understand it, but it's interesting, I guess.
Hey, Shyhards. Marlene Barrett here with Kristen Hager from Chicago Med, along with some of the fantastic actresses from Chicago Fire and TV. And we're going to showcase the important role that women play in the One Chicago universe.
We know the answer to that.
Wait! You pointed last to me? Oh my gosh! Like it's you take true. 15 takes, Marlene.
That's not true, it's not
oh
true.
My
Marlene
God.
Is a one take wonder. You heard it here first.
Neither?
Yeah. Oh.
Oh yes. It's me.
Yeah, probably me. Oh yeah, medical training was integral. So I came out to Chicago a full week early to just do full days with two of our fantastic active trauma mm-hmm. surgeons that work down the street from the studio. It was like a boot camp of how to get your PhD over the span of a week. And it was incredible.
The authenticity requires a consistent training from us because, I mean, I don't know what most of these procedures are,
yeah.
You know? Yes, of course. I don't go a season without coming back and at least catching up with Bobbin or the Dennises, who are our medical consultants, and make sure that we get a chance to at least visit at the hospital and remind ourselves what the atmosphere is in an ED, the rhythm in which mm-hmm. life is really lived. That X-ray machine, I cannot.
Yeah.
It's like on hydraulics. So it's like a moon machine.
Yeah.
So when they yell action, they expect you like, move it, turn.
Fortunately, I don't have to use the X-ray machine.
There you go.
I think just this sense of camaraderie between your coworkers I mean, again, we're shooting a television show, so it's like this giant family, but I do believe that it must be that way when stakes are so high day in and day out.
VIPs aren't your cup of tea, I take it.
I like them, just from a distance.
Maggie and her organ donations, my goodness. She's just like, you know, stranger off the street, you need a kidney? Here you go. I'll give you mine. Haven't seen you in about 15 years, but you know, you're about to die. I will give you one of my organs. I will give you blood. I will give you anything you need. I don't need them.
I'm gonna see if I can get you moved up on the transplant list.
Maggie, you've taken such good care of me. Thank you.
This season, the first episode I shot with you and Guy, I mean, we laughed so much. It was hysterical.
Especially when everyone's together.
Yeah.
Like, we just shot this Christmas episode where everyone was together in this room, actually, and it was so impossible to control anyone.
And the joy of being together.
Yeah.
We're like kids, and you're like, oh my God, all the school's coming together.
Yeah, it is.
I haven't seen you forever.
That's a really hard question to answer because so many people in this cast are so funny. Marlene is up there, though, for me. she's a comedian.
Number one makes me laugh. I think it would have to go to Gelfish. So Nick Gelfish makes me laugh so much that I gave him this name, Nick Gelfish. And Gelfish is because he's just pliable. He grabs anything and turns it into a one-liner. He's comfortable with his comedy. And it's so crazy because you guys know him as such an intense character that's like, you know, frowned and is like, oh no, I don't want to kill this person.
Just stick to the script.
Stevie doesn't hold back. She's a fighter.
She could have had another stroke at any minute. What was I supposed to do?
She's my patient, Will. You were afraid that I would disagree and I'd stop you.
No.
It's the same old Will from med school.
There's something that I find is very similar between our two characters is this ability to put the bravado on to get the job done.
Yeah.
They're not hard, but they're firm in their commitment to get the job done and they'll deal with the emotion of it after.
Yeah. I think it's essential to be telling these women's stories about the women in the ED and showing their strengths and weaknesses. And I think that all three of these shows do a fantastic job at elevating women's stories.
I think in the One Chicago world, there's this true understanding of feminism, that we're just strong, we're women, we can be sexy, and we can kick butt all at the same time. I did a scene with Nick Gelfish where my sister's boyfriend was abusing her, and we went to a dealership, a car dealership, and I had to punch him. I mean, I wanted to drop kick him. You know, I wanted an actual crouching tiger, hidden dragon. But it was too much. You know, that's a Chicago man.
I had a much more minor stunt
than
that. One of the patients, husband of the patient actually, grabs my arm and I tell him to remove it and he doesn't. And I tell him again to remove it and he doesn't. So then I push him off of me. And the thing is, he then becomes slightly confused, loses his balance, falls to the ground, but he had to hit a tray on the way down, send things flying, and fall to the floor. So technically it was considered a stunt, although it was a very light push. And
I'm not sure it was a light push, Kristen. Anything that has to do with Brian T having rain fall on his chest, it should be considered a stunt because he's hurting the rain.
Some of my favorite scenes thus far have been the ones with my mom. I just think that we...
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, I think there was some really special stuff there.
When I think about my favorite scene, I think it's when I received the diagnostic that Maggie was cancer-free. I think Maggie was gonna do anything and everything to get an opportunity to meet this daughter, a second chance at life. And every time the journey between meeting the people that did adopt her, then having to just accept that she went into a good family, but she went in it knowing that there was no way she couldn't pursue this relationship.
That was fun. Thank you, Marlene. And we hope you guys enjoyed it too.
Our city.
It's crying out for help.
We answer this together.
We look after each other.
You will come back from this.
Just trying to do the right thing.
I'm not leaving you!
This is a fan theory from Shelley York on YouTube. Wonder if Mouch is gonna be lieutenant of 81 now. No, Mouch is not going to be the lieutenant of anything. I think the plan for the character from the very beginning was to have one guy who served 30-something years in the CFD as a ground-level, blue-collar grunt type and started that way and retired that way. That's what they want for me. I don't think they ever want Mouch to be a lieutenant. I'm very sorry, but thank you for thinking of it.
This is a fan theory from Chicago 51 fan on Instagram.
Violet and Gala will actually go on a date. Oh.
Wouldn't that be nice? Wouldn't that be so nice if they went on like a normal date?
Hey, Violet, the other night when you kissed me?
Oh, yeah.
Well, I was thinking maybe we should go on a date again soon, see where it goes.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking too.
That would actually be a lot of fun if they went to like a baseball game or a hockey game. Yeah, it'd be funny also if like Violet was the one that was like really into the game. Gala has to calm her down because she's like in a fight with someone. That would actually be really fun, yeah.
It would be really interesting to see them existing as a normal romantic couple outside of the firehouse because I think every aspect of their relationship has been abnormal.
We can't do this. Now we can.
This is a fan theory from Jackson Brown on Facebook. I genuinely hope to see Stella Kidd take over as truck lieutenant. That's what's up. Me too.
We are not done yet.
For One Chicago Day coming right up.
You think you know Trudy Platt?
You know I got shot in the ass, right?
You don't know Trudy Platt.
I did half the guys in my class at the academy.
Forget I said anything, Sergeant.
If I could find out anything about Trudy Platt, what would I want to know? I feel like there was a point in her life where she was a spy. And I would love to know those stories.
It's actually insane.
To know about her, there's so many things to choose from. I'd like to know how she takes her hot dog.
Why don't we just keep this party rolling?
I'd want to find out what Trudy Platt's family changed their names from to Platt.
Yeah, yeah.
What does she do in her alone time? What's she into, you know? Maybe she's like a big gamer, you know, with the headset and the whole thing.
I'd love to see where she comes from. Just what is the family life like there?
That is just fine.
If there's any way that Sylvie could be close friends with her, I suspect that the answer is no.
I would like to know if and what Trudy dreams about.
Furtis, dreams never go out of business. Ever.
When is that amazing actress gonna do another play? She's phenomenal.
Yeah, you're damn right.
I wanna know what everybody wants to know. White Sox or Cubs?
Where in the world is her happy place?
Let me tell you, it's always cool.
Woo! Yeah!
And boss don't mind sometimes if you act a fool.
I'd mostly like to know if she would like to take me under her wing, you know, as she's done with so many other young first responders.
Hey, tough stuff. It's a peace offering, so get over yourself and accept it, okay?
Well, look at you, all overdressed.
I can't tell if I would love it or hate it. I think I would love it.
Like, what does she do when she leaves work? Who is Trudy Platt? Really?
Tiger Beat, go get some coffee. This is girl talk.
Trudy Platt, married to Mouch. Does he buy her jewelry?
Look at that. It's like a ray of sunshine around your finger.
I feel like I want to know more about where she got all this money from her daddy. Because her and Mouch are pretty loaded, but somehow they're playing it super low key. Like, why are they still working? You know, it's like they're super, super loaded. I want to know more about that money.
Does she scrub his back when they shower together?
I would want to know anything
She's a mystery.
She's a tough cookie, my little cookie.
Where do they live? Whose house did they pick?
Some people have pajamas, and some people just go to sleep. But is there, like, pajamas? A set that Trudy Platt goes to sleep with? Perhaps that Mouch picked out.
I want to know, like, what music she, like, loves to dance to, what makes her feel sexy.
I think he's the better cook because of the firehouse, so he technically has culinary gift under that, and she loves him for that.
I think one of the first interactions that Severide had with Platt was he was at the police station, and she said if they went out, she'd break him like a stick. I would like to see what that looks like.
Dinner? Oh, I'm just messing with you. You wouldn't be able to handle me anyway. Snap you right in half.
What do I want to know about Trudy Platt? What's on her bucket list?
A god's eye view of her playing with Barbie dolls when she was about 8 years old. That would touch my heart.
One of the most compelling things about Trudy Platt is that she has this tough exterior.
Come on, Sarge, you're my homegirl. You know that.
But most people I know who have tough exteriors, they're just protecting a very soft, gooey center. I want to know what's going on in there.
Oh. Thank you, Sarge.
I think people should know that she is an excellent square dancer.
I'll see you tomorrow.
No, I'll see you tomorrow.
It's hard to pick, like, one scene. Instead of one scene, I'd say all those scenes over the years when the entire cast is on set. For instance, this year we did a big Christmas scene in this space, in fact. When you're working, you don't get to see everybody, and it's just really a lot of fun when we're all together.
Matthew Cooper, you're under arrest for violation of Title 18 for fraud.
Wait, what? What the hell?
Jessica Rinaldi, you're under arrest for violation of Title 18 for fraud. Any false statements you make to the FBI are punishable for up to 5 years in prison.
You called the FBI?
I did. Any and all fallout lands on me, not you.
And believe me, Sharon, there will be fallout.
The pressure in his skull needs to be released.
Figure something out now.
That's easy. When Will Halstead is drilling a hole into the mob guy's head in a boatyard in his tuxedo while everyone is waiting for him at the church on his wedding day.
Pop.
I think one of my favorite scenes, if not my favorite scene, at the end of an episode in our first season when a gentleman who tried to convince us that he had just come in because he had misjudged a traffic light and got hit by a car.
I mean, it's totally my bad, but still, whatever happened to pedestrians having the right of way?
Dr. Charles figures out that he actually was trying to hurt himself. Like a lot of people who have, you know, mental health issues, they don't want to talk about them. Because for some reason they think something's wrong with them. It turned into this cat and mouse game in which Dr. Charles actually has to reveal things about himself to get this guy to tell the truth so that he can be helped.
You're a hell of a performer. I mean, a real trooper. I mean, you're keeping it up for so long. Carrying around the weight of that performance. I think it'd be exhausting.
I have absolutely no excuse to be sad.
You don't need an excuse, man. You're a human being.
It was beautifully written and a very moving scene, and I think that might be my favorite one of many.
My favorite scene this far on the show is in episode 4 with the young man who was diagnosed with schizophrenia, and I just think it was such a powerful scene that everybody on set, directors, cameramen, background actors, and people who weren't even supposed to be on the set were crying.
Hey, look, I'm a doctor, all right? This man is experiencing a psychiatric episode. Please, just let me work with him. Hey, Roland.
I don't see you.
Hey, I'm right here. I'm right here. Just focus on my voice. Hey, Roland. I just need you to breathe deep for me, okay? Come on, don't stop. Come on.
Please. Here you are.
I'm here. I got you. I'll never forget that scene. It was really special.
I love crossing over to fire. I love crossing over to fire because there's so much testosterone. These guys are just crazy. They carry so much gear, and Maggie comes in with her dainty little outfit. And I got a chance to check out if Severide was doing good. And who don't mind that? I wanted to make sure he was healthy. Healthy he was.
This is a really good thing that you're doing, Kelly. Anna's a great girl.
Well, I'm just glad I could help her.
Actually, I don't have one favorite scene on Chicago Med. I just love all the actual surgery scenes that I'm allowed to do. To get in and root around inside somebody's torso, rearrange organs just for the heck of it, is a blast.
All right, looks like you're good to close.
Actually, we're just gonna pack and leave her open.
Hi, Shyhards. I am Miranda Ray Mayo, Stella Kidd from Chicago Fire. Stella has evolved from a firefighter on Truck 81 to a lieutenant. And this is her journey to get there.
He's the newest member of Truck 81, Stella Kidd.
All right. Show me what you got, 51. Hey, what's up?
I had no idea for the entire length of that training course that you were married.
Yeah, something you might have wanted to check into before you let yourself in my back door with a six-pack.
Well, I'm sorry. And I'm glad you're here.
Good talk.
Good talk.
Springfield Training Ground next week. The IAFF, they are hosting an event for future fire service leaders, and I would be very grateful if you represented our district.
Me?
If you're willing.
I am.
You show great potential.
I just don't see where I fit into all this.
What do you mean?
I don't have any leadership experiences to share.
Chief thinks you do.
Those of you who do not know, Kidd identified potential criminal activity during our last fire. Stella Kidd, that is wonderful work. And we should all look to your example. I just want to let you know I signed you up at the academy.
Oh, I already took the rescue tech certification, so.
No. To be an instructor.
Oh.
You know, it's a great way to get your name out there, establish yourself as a potential leader in the department.
Thank you, Chief. Can you just tell me that I got this one more time?
You got this, Stella Kidd.
Cadets! This is your instructor, Stella Kidd. When she says jump, you don't say anything because you will already be jumping. Got it?
Yes, Chief!
Okay. Hello. I just want to say that this is my first time leading the class, but, you know, not long ago, I was in your shoes. Okay. Let's just get to it. High plank position. And hold it for 60. 59, 58, 57, 56. I have a program I'm looking to start that'll benefit young women, and I need a female officer to co-sponsor. I'm calling it Girls on Fire. And the idea is I reach out to public school girls and show them what a career in the fire service is all about.
I'm in.
Captain, didn't know you'd be joining us today.
Where are your recruits?
Kylie. You said it's the best job in the world, so I brought a few friends. Hope that's cool.
Yeah, I figured you would.
All right, recruits, line up. All right, let's have some fun. You're looking for me, Chief?
Yeah, there are not enough women or people of color in leadership positions inside of the CFD. So when the lieutenant's test is offered in a few months, I want you to take it.
Hey, Chief said you need these books for the lieutenant's exam.
Thanks, Kylie. This is a lot.
Hey, Chief, what do you have?
I'm gonna need to speak to kid. Headquarters called. Exam results are in. So I'm gonna need a round for the house, Lieutenant.
Oh!
What?
Oh. What? Oh. Oh.
I need you.
So, there is a lieutenant spot open on truck 72. The truck needs some leadership. It'd be a challenge.
And?
I told Bowden I want it.
You're gonna be a damn good lieutenant, wherever you go. Hope it's not out of line to ask, but doesn't Kid seem like the natural replacement for Casey?
You are not leaving 81 to go over to 72, because I am.
Okay, but Bowden.
I already cleared it.
I don't know what to say.
You don't have to say anything. Just gotta start giving orders.
Yes, sir.
You good, Lieutenant?
Yeah, I'm good.
Good.
I'm Tracy Spiridakis, and I love that I get to be here with Marina Scorciati and Amy Morton to talk about Chicago PD.
Hands down.
For sure. There's
hands
no question.
Down. Unless you're going for comedy. Then
yeah.
I win.
Yeah.
I have a lot of parking tickets.
So it's good, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't have any. My car is like a teenager's car. It's like learning to drive. It's like a bumper car. Like I was turning out of my garage, and I'm like, why can't I move? And then the maintenance man had to come with a 2x4 and lift up my car to get it out. Just happened, everybody, right? But it's
why don't you decide?
Oh, there you go.
It's beautiful.
Me?
Yeah.
Well, you think?
Yeah. That was really fun. Plus, I got to enter the scene really fast in a police car. That was really fun, because I don't get to drive that much. And yeah, you know, there's nothing more fun for me as Trudy than to screw with people. So it's a win-win for everybody.
It was very intense. I feel like I actually did have a panic attack in that scene.
I can't breathe.
Okay, I think you're having a panic attack. Come here.
And luckily, I have experience with anxiety, so it worked out perfectly. I was
thank
like,
goodness.
Let me recall from a moment. Oh, yes, I know.
I think that she's kind of masking her suffering because she has a kid. Like, I think if she didn't have a kid, she'd be able to sort of get through it and dwell on it and, like, do therapy and have the time. But when you're a working mom, you just don't have time to focus on yourself that much. So I think it might come back up, it might resurface, but right now I think she's just trucking through for Michaela.
When I joined, I worked with Looch, how to like properly clear a room and stuff like that, but that's all I did.
We did, we went to ranges.
Yeah.
We came here a week early, or maybe like 2 weeks to train.
Did you train?
No, I just talked to a couple of desk sergeants.
Oh, yeah.
And Looch.
I feel like I definitely did at the beginning. I feel like now it's almost
second nature
at this point, I think.
And if we do something new, Lucha's there to like
help us and like guide us through. Yeah. And tell us we look like idiots. Yeah. Which he's not afraid to say.
Which he is definitely not afraid to say.
Yeah, he's like, you look stupid. I gotta tell you. Nobody's gonna tell you, I gotta tell you.
Nothing.
Everything's easy for you?
Well, yeah, pens and phones, they're real frickin' hard. You know what I mean? A radio, you know? Oh, except there was once I'm supposed to talk into the radio and we're about to shoot and Luch says, freeze. And I freeze and he comes in and he turns the radio around and he goes, continue. And I was like, shh. Oh, well.
I don't have an answer.
Tracy continually gets butted with the battering ram.
That does happen to me, actually, a
so,
lot.
Like, in the swing back, I don't know why, but Tracy.
I have like welts on my leg, all, and it's this leg, because it's always the boys going first yeah. with the ram,
yeah.
and then they stop, and they don't, you know, they freeze or
and
whatever,
just throw
and then right in my leg.
Yeah. We don't even bother like asking her if she's okay anymore. She's not. She's permanently damaged.
I didn't realize how much desk sergeants are in charge of absolutely everything that goes on in that house, in that police station. I really didn't understand the enormity of the job.
I thought it was really interesting learning about interview, like being in the interview room and paying attention to, you know, body language and looking at somebody's eyes and trying to see, you know, what's going on. I thought that was a really cool learning. I mean, we do like a portion of it, but then stunts will come in and do the real hard stuff. Like, there's a moment coming up where my character goes into the lake, and my stunt double came up to me and was
but
like-
But in December, you have to say
but
it's
in December.
December. It's not like the August lake.
Right, and my-
it's December lake.
Yes, and my stunt double came up to me and said, I hear we're going into the lake, and I said, I think I'm going into a pool. I think you're going into the lake. We get to play and we get to do some of the running and jumping, but our stunts are incredible.
I loved watching myself get blown backwards.
Really?
Oh my God, and I loved watching them do it. They both got yanked by catapult typey things backwards. And it was stunning. It was really something.
Kelly recently, her stunt double got hit by a car.
Yeah, that was.
And apparently the focus puller almost stopped the take. And Patty was in front with a gun, and he just like hurt a body. And everyone wanted to stop because it looked so violent. And she was totally fine.
She's so incredible. Yeah. She just jumped. I texted her about it the next day. I was like, how are you feeling?
Kyle showed it to me and went, oh, like
yeah.
it was awful.
Yeah. And I'm like, how are you feeling? She's like, I'm all right, a little bruised. What?
Yeah. I was like, but she was genuinely hit by a car.
Yeah. Meanwhile, I'm complaining about the frickin' ram in my thigh. And we're still talking about it days later.
For us.
One of my favorite moments to watch was the episode where Voight is screaming down the stairs, this is my unit, like a baby. He realizes that the force has to change. And that he can't do things the way he used to do things. And I guess what I was so intrigued about was the fact that he wasn't a tough guy fighting back. He was standing at the top of the stairs and he was like yelling like a kid, like, this is mine, this is mine.
This is my unit. And in my unit, we do what we gotta do to put bad guys away, whatever it takes.
I thought that was great.
Oh. When you guys were eating like Chinese food on the steps of your million-dollar apartment. by the way, Kim Burgess lives in a hovel, and you guys are like, you're clearly funneling money. Anyway, you guys have this like lovely like scene of like you're suffering and hiding it, and Halsted is kind of just like doesn't know, is kind of on the up and up. It was just a lovely like I felt like a real couple scene, two people eating. I don't know.
Dude, you at the end of eight. Season eight. You
yeah.
are a beast.
Beastie. No!
Beastie. Just.
Beastie.
Yeah.
Thanks.
We laugh a lot.
Yeah, we have a lot of fun.
We do laugh a lot.
One time we went, I think it was like a kid's party, and there was a bouncy house. Do you remember what happened with Patty? It was either a trampoline or a bouncy house, but there was no center. It was just like for the set. It was just like, just like, it's the ground. That was the most fun he had.
Well, that's good. There isn't just one person, and we make fun of each other a lot. And look for opportunities to play pranks on each other. I don't know if I could just pick one person, because everyone shines on different days and different moments.
Okay, this has been so fantastic. I love hanging out with you ladies.
And we are so excited that we get to spend time with you all.
And we will see you on Wednesdays, Tryhards.
Face the facts now and make this a whole lot easier on everyone.
I'm your partner, for better or worse.
You got a bad guy.
Don't go anywhere, Shyhards. We've got a lot more for you on this one Chicago day.
Will Gallo and Violet rekindle their flame?
Wow, they are quite the seesaw, right? Like, you think they're gonna do it, and then they don't, then you think they're not, and then they want it. Oh, hi.
Hey, you were right. It has been fun hanging out as friends. But don't forget about this.
I think they both have so much to learn themselves and what I think they need from each other.
Gallo seems like a player. Not really what I'm in the mood for.
Does that look like a player to you? I mean,
and he makes a solid point.
What is Sylvie's romantic future? I know what I'd like it to be. Just, you know, something. But they're working long distance, so she's gotta get on a plane every once in a while. Take a visit, you know, it's a two-way street. She'll do it, she loves him.
Seriously, zero pressure. I want you to come.
As far as paramedicine goes, obviously we need to see more of Brett and Mouch together, because they're a great team.
I'm so glad to hear you say this. I gotta admit, I'm excited. I came onto Molly's late. This, I've gotten to be a part of from the inception.
A big part.
I hope that we get to see more paramedicine, because she put a lot of work into that, so come on, let's see more paramedicine. I gotta drive that toaster van around a lot more.
I do not know when the wedding is. I didn't get that script yet.
When is the Stellaride wedding? Oh. I'm just gonna, give me one second. Hi, Andrea Newman's office, please? Yes, this is Miranda Mayo. I'm just wondering about, right. Yes, I do know that she is show running a show and she's a very busy woman. Okay, if you could just tell her to call me back. Okay, great, thanks, bye. I don't know.
A spin-off of the rescues on the beaches and lakes.
Lake Watch.
Chicago Lake Watch. We're probably gonna have Severide shirtless, like slow-mo running along the beach, because I think that's what we all want to see.
Whoa! Kill the motor!
I say starring Tony Ferraris.
They want to see me and Ritter in a bathing suit having like a whole moment and being like, you gotta dive in there, Ritter. And him being like, yeah, I'll go. I need to get in better shape.
You're only gonna have swimwear for like 3 months out of the year, right? Most of the time, there's gonna be people in like scuba gear.
In Chicago, it would look really snowy.
It's colder by the lake. Like when you get the temperature in the morning, you'll get also like, and by the lake, it's negative 10.
Windy.
It's very cold by the lake.
Icy.
I can't imagine being by lakeshore in the winter doing stuff in the water.
They would be icy cold scenes to shoot.
Chicago's beach is, I mean, it's not really a beach, but nothing against that.
Deceptively cold beach day. Hey, it's sunny, it must be nice out. It is not nice out.
Anyone inside?
I don't know. No one saw it happen.
Most of the emergencies that would happen on the beach in Chicago would be like probably whenever it was freezing cold, like, oh no, I'm stuck beneath the ice. Oh, let me get out there. Let me put my foot warmers in.
Got it. We're good.
I would advocate that it would only shoot in the summer.
Stella, there is no chance we're calling for a rescue. Zero.
You make that show. I will watch it.
No, it's freezing here. No, not gonna do it.
God bless those actors. Jumping into the lake in the wintertime.
All right, go.
Does that sound fun to anyone? That is not a show that I will be on because I'm already dead inside because it's so cold.
Yeah, we could get a spinoff of, like, Beach Patrol. Right, Dick Wolf, dude.
Let's stream that, not only on Wednesdays at midnight, but also on Peacock.
Oh, my goodness. Okay, here we go.
Do we really want to revisit some of this stuff?
Let's see. Season 5, Dr. Charles, Episode 7, you helped a patient who thought he was a vampire.
I'm a vampire.
Okay, hold on.
What was his actual medical condition? A, he had hepatitis C. B, he was anemic. C, he was a werewolf.
Hep C. A. He had Hep C.
Okay.
Thomas, hepatitis C.
Huh.
Is this your vampire? Does that explain why he blistered in the sun?
Probably got it from having sex with his girlfriend.
Or from sucking her blood. Yikes.
In the pilot, Sharon Goodwin, how was Chicago Med's audience introduced to your character? A, giving a speech. B, firing an employee. C, training an employee.
I think it was giving a speech.
I did too. And you know who was there?
The mayor.
The former mayor.
Yes, the former mayor.
That's how long we've been doing this.
Our mayor, Rahm Emanuel. After returning to Chicago from Milwaukee, where does Charles's ex-wife, Susan, want to take their daughter, Anna?
Arizona.
A.
Arizona.
B.
Arizona.
C.
Arizona.
I think the answer is Arizona.
Yeah, moving can be stressful, especially long distances to, say, someplace like Arizona.
Didn't shoot that long ago. What is etomidate?
Don't know. Something else is up. All right, I'm intubating. Let's go. 100 of sucks, 20 of etomidate. Come on.
A short-acting intravenous fluid.
You were a charge nurse, weren't you?
She was indeed.
Sharon Goodwin, true or false? Gaffney Chicago Medical Center is a real hospital or not a real hospital?
It is a real hospital on television. Indeed, here's the deal. Gaffney is the maiden name of our creator's mother, Dick Wolf.
It's Dickie Wolf's world and we just live in it.
It is indeed. Describe our character's friendship using medical jargon.
I mean, it's just great. I can't, like, medical jargon is used to describe things that are sort of wrong with people. It's very healthy.
There you go.
Yeah, it's very dependable.
It helps when I remember that I have people in my corner that love me. And God knows you got that in droves.
It's what makes the world go round for Chucky.
They've known each other for a long time. She's known you through 4 marriages and we don't know how many children.
That's right.
Plus, we like to laugh.
Good morning.
Hey. Oh, you bought me a coffee.
Of course I did. They spelled your name wrong.
Daniel, you stole somebody's coffee.
I left him $5. He's an old friend of mine.
Well, okay, what advice did you really want to give Maggie about working with her daughter?
Treat her kid like a professional.
Right.
And yet that's impossible to do, which makes for some great television.
Absolutely.
You said your door was always open.
And as you can see, I ain't no fibber.
So you've been doing this for 7 seasons. psychoanalyze Sharon Goodwin?
I know I'm telling you, I'm trying to slither out of the question.
But you don't psychoanalyze friends.
You don't psychoanalyze your friends. She, because she's such a good friend, she took that right out of my mouth. I ain't going to psychoanalyze my friend. She's my friend.
There you go.
It was a pleasure spending some time with you talking about Chicago Med, or anything for that matter.
It's always fun to be with you. And of course, we'll see you on Wednesdays, Shyhards. Boom.
Boom.
I'm Miranda Ray Mayo, and I am excited to be here with my Chicago Fire gals, Kara Kilmer and Hanako Greensmith, as we chat about our roles at 51.
Yeah. Me?
Yeah. You've been busting out some funny ones.
That was Alberto. It was one time he made me laugh.
That was really
and
good.
And I couldn't keep it together.
Alberto pretended to poop himself.
One time.
It was good. Chicago Fire. Hands
probably
down.
You would, actually, because you know all the stuff.
I just like fires.
It really should go towards someone who's slightly pyromaniac, so.
All we know is that it's not me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's me. Ooh, I feel like that's almost a tie.
Oh, what? Really?
Yes. Kara is like married.
Oh, well, that is a gigantic difference between
the
character and I.
Married once.
Sure.
Steady, Jason married. Sure. Stable.
Everything
you know?
Sylvie wants.
I went through some training with Steve Chikorotis, who is the best. Eamon and Jesse actually came to my first training session with Chick. It was so, they were so like their,
yeah.
like their roles. Like, it was
so
awesome.
Cute.
Both Kara and I actually did the IFSI Fire College.
Yeah.
We did it at different times, but you know.
That so was... glad I'm playing a paramedic. That's the takeaway.
I wanted to do more training, but I think because of COVID, it's been harder shadowing people at firehouses, which is a bummer. But we do have incredible real life paramedics who come to set, and every time we have a scene that includes anything involving our work, they're there. It's not the same as shadowing, but I definitely get a slice of what their real life looks like. It's very impressive.
I have been driving the Ambo now for 8 years.
And she whips it.
Eighth season. I do drive slightly dangerously. I feel like I should become an honorary stunt driver.
Agreed.
I'm just gonna put that out there.
I've done my own stunts when a kid rescues Severide from the Chicago River.
Bring us up!
Which, like, blessings Taylor, like, was in the Chicago River in February. Like,
oh.
What about y'all?
We love our stunt people.
Yeah.
We
yeah.
love them. Cherish them at all costs.
Yes. Yeah. Protect and cherish them.
Blessings yes. and totally. Protect.
I think that she was annoyed at first. She's like, why are all of you? Why are all of you out there? What? What's going on?
Oh no, if you die, do I get that cool loft? Like...
I think yeah. she was trying not to have a panic attack.
If they're gonna succeed together romantically, they have to come together with what's truly tying them together, which is friendship. And I think that's the start of any good relationship, is you like that person before you love that person. There was a scene in season 8 when we're all at a different firehouse, and I remember there's an exchange between Brett and Casey where she talks about how 51 is different.
One of the first things you learn at the academy is you get the victim to the hospital best you can and you don't look back. As soon as I started at 51, I noticed nobody follows that rule here, especially you.
And how everyone doesn't do a good job of following the rules of like leaving work behind. They always kind of take work with them. They go the extra mile to make sure that their victims are okay and people that they tend to are, you know, it stays with them. And that Casey is a little extra that way. So I think it's kind of interesting that even though Sylvie is at this crossroads of having to make a decision to move with Casey or stay and dedicate herself to paramedicine, the reason that she stays is really because of the influence of Casey, because he's the one who has led by example time and time again that you follow through.
I think a lot of the medical equipment can get tricky. Like, certain things, surprisingly, the IV, I can forget a step, which a nurse or paramedic or a doctor never would.
There's a lot of cowboy switches with all of our medical supplies, mm-hmm. which can also get tricky once it turns cold, mm-hmm. because your fingers yeah. are like,
totally.
Good luck. There's a lot more love making and making out than I thought. Was
that's
required for being a paramedic. You know, it's a hard job to do, but we'll do it.
But I honestly think that in the pandemic, I learned so much more about what paramedics have really suffered through. Mm. The past few years, there's been so much PTSD and trauma, and the fact that they can't really make ends meet, and then they're still doing other jobs at the same time. God, I find it profoundly inspiring.
I had no idea that most firefighters have a second, third job.
You totally.
Know what I mean? It really is people putting their lives mm-hmm. on the line for very little money. In the summertime, when it's like a particularly nice day and we're out on an incident, mm-hmm. like those days feel like Sunday picnics.
They really do.
Totally. Well, let's see. Anytime there's a breakfast scene, it's a delicious time on set.
Truth.
Oh my gosh, the waffles.
I was just about to say the waffles.
It's good stuff.
Yeah.
I put a fart machine under the bed for my love scene with Casey.
And you also.
I also wore fake hillbilly teeth. Anytime they blow something up, it's super cool. It
so
just doesn't get old.
It really doesn't.
The best special effects team known to man.
Truly.
Truly.
It's fireworks all the time.
I loved the scene with Bowden and me where he's telling Stella that he believes in her and that he thinks she can be a leader. I remember I had said like I wanted to be in more stuff with Eamon, and then it happened and it was magnificent. It's been such a masterclass.
I don't know if I can pinpoint it to like an exact one because I've had so many, I'm grateful to say, with Daniel and Alberto. As much as I love our scenes, I equally love the scenes with them because it's just, man, it's just joy. Other things too, like I think I've really enjoyed working with Hawkins, Jimmy Nicholas. It's been really, really interesting to see how Violet changes when she's not with Gallo, you know? She's different from person to person because she's a human. But also Hawkins brings out something different for her. And I think that's exciting.
Even though there are stereotypes that women aren't strong, it's just not true.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? It's just not true. I actually think she falls into a lot of stereotypes about women, that they're caring, that they're nurturing, that they're strong, that they're brave, that they take on more than they necessarily need to or should and don't complain about it. She's a woman.
Yeah, that was a good
one. That needs an applause.
That was the one.
Yeah.
You gotta balance it out, you know? You need to have some fun with the ladies, you know?
That's
and
right.
And the more of them on screen at one time, the better.
You
know? And it is inspiring. Mm-hmm. It's inspiring to see the ladies kicking butt and, you know, especially like watching all of our characters mature and seeing them grow in their relationships and in their jobs and like pursue their ambitions is like, it's really special this many seasons in.
This has been so awesome and I'm so glad I got to be a part of it. And we love doing this for you, our Shy Hearts.
My favorite scene that I have done, I think it's the first episode, there's a scene where we kind of all get into like a tactical line. And I just remember feeling so much adrenaline and so much excitement because I knew that this show was gonna be kind of badass.
It's clean. Can't make any guarantees though.
My favorite scene of all of the One Chicago's thus far is the second time Matt Water lost his virginity with his second shot at love, Mr. Les Nichols.
How do two people at a bar talk for hours and fail to learn each other's names? You want to dance?
Mm-hmm. I do.
I just like it because it was an opportunity for us to see a different side of Atwater. We usually see him breaching down doors and quite perplexed most of the time, but it was nice to kind of watch him enjoy himself.
Talk to me.
We're getting personal now, huh?
Yeah, well, it might as well. Mm-hmm. Unless you want to be made nameless.
It was fast.
Okay.
Oh, my favorite scene. You realize we've done 175 episodes. Dramatically would probably be the episode where I lost the baby. There's so many to choose from in that episode, and it all tested me in a way. They were all hard to figure out, hard to shoot, hard to act.
I'll be right here, Kim. Still right here.
My favorite scene of the show that I've ever done is the first scene that I was ever in. It was the first day that I worked on the show with Elias Koteas playing Alvin Alinsky.
I needed him 5 minutes ago.
He picks me out of the academy because I'm trying to talk a suicide having a gun to his head, and instead I just kick him over in his chair and take the gun from him.
You want to kill yourself?
You know what? I'll do it.
What do you think about that?
What the hell are you doing?
You said the goal was to get the gun out of his hands.
He says we'll take him. My favorite scene I've ever done.
We'll take him.
You know what? I did really enjoy doing the scene with North, too, but that was also this year. The scene with North where I finally got to, like, you know, Upton kind of comes back to herself and sticks it to North a little bit.
I made that promise to Mark Irwin because he had a gun pointed to a civilian's head, and that's what he wanted to hear in that moment. That's textbook police work. So since I'm very obviously not under arrest, I'm going back to work now. I'm a great cop. I'm in the middle of working a murder, and you're wasting my goddamn time.
That was a fun scene too.
I think my favorite scene was kind of long ago. I think it was with Voight after my father got murdered. I'm about to wreak havoc and retribution on his killer.
We need to talk.
You shouldn't have come here, Hank.
Trudy.
I need to do this,
Trudy.
And you shouldn't be
Trudy,
here.
Listen, you gotta calm down. It's just me. Okay, I need the truth so I can fix this.
There's no fixing
Trudy,
this.
Trudy, I have put a lot worse back together. Right now, you and I have got to get on the same page because people are going to be double-checking our work.
Then you need to let me finish what I came here to do. You of all people should understand
You're
this.
You're not me, Trudy. You wouldn't be able to live with yourself.
He killed my dad. He killed my dad.
I know. He'll do his time.
And Voight saves me and gets me out of doing that. And I think that was probably my favorite scene.
Really hope you enjoyed this year's One Chicago Day.
And don't forget to tune in to One Chicago on Wednesdays starting at 8, 7 Central.
And streaming on Peacock.